Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to today's lecture. My name is Sandy Hager. I'm a fellow in international political economy here at the LSE in the Department of International Relations. And it's a great pleasure for me to be able to introduce today's speaker, Jonathan Nitzan. Jonathan is a professor of political economy at York University in Toronto. And together with his longtime collaborator, Shimshon Bickler, Jonathan has done something remarkable. He's developed an entirely new theory of political economy, one that conceptualizes capitalism as a mode of power. This new capitalist power framework is born out of three decades of research on inflation, energy conflicts in the Middle East, incarceration, the global financial crisis, and much more. Now, before Jonathan speaks, I just want to draw your attention to two websites that I think might be of interest. The first is Bickler and Nitzan's own website, the BN Archives, which is posted here. At this website, you can find most of their publications free of charge, and the URL for that website is bnarchives.net. The second website is a website for a new research project that's been inspired by the work of Jonathan and Shimshon, and that's the Forum on Capitalist Power. The purpose of this forum is to bring together people from all over the world who are interested in advancing power-centered research to political economy, and the URL for that website is capitalistpower.com. So without further ado, I'd like to turn things over to Jonathan, his presentation today is going to address the provocative and important, but also largely neglected question of whether or not capitalists can afford recovery. So, leave it to Jonathan.
Okay, thank you, Sandy, and thank you, everybody, for being here this Sunday afternoon. Recovery. I think that a lot of commentators, whether they are economic commentators or financial commentators, or social commentators in general, are still preoccupied with the question of recovery. The world remains mirrored in a serious crisis, and it's a lingering crisis. And the key question seems to be how to get out of this crisis. And what I'd like to do today is to raise a question that very few people ask, and I think nobody has answered. And that is whether capitalists can afford recovery in the first place. Now, this question does not come out of the blue. Over the past few years, from just around the beginning of the current stage of the crisis, 2008 and onwards, Shimshon and I have been arguing that this crisis is a systemic crisis. In other words, it's a crisis that threatens perhaps the very existence of capitalism, and that capitalists in this crisis have been struck by what we call systemic fear. This fear is objectively grounded, we claimed. And it's objectively grounded in a way that is quite different from the explanations that are given by heterodox political economists, particularly Marxists. From the Marxist perspective, this crisis, in some sense, is a combination of a gradual weakening of the accumulation process. And we argue, in fact, to the contrary, that this crisis comes or is born out of the tremendous power of capitalists. So it's actually an opposite explanation. On the one side, you have gradual weakening, and we argue that capitalism has been incredibly powerful, and crisis is born out of this hubris peak of capitalist power. Now, these almost diametrically opposed perspectives are anchored in two different cosmologies, or so it seems. The conventional cosmology that I think Marxist political economists share with mainstream economist is the view of capitalism as a mode of production and consumption. So it's a view of capitalism as based essentially in an economic system. And we think of capitalism quite differently. We think of capitalism as a mode of power. And we think of capital as an institution of power. So these are two very different starting points of analysis, although there are many overlaps between our analysis and the Marxist framework. There are also very significant differences. Now, if we think of capitalism as a mode of power and of capital as power, then immediately there's this issue of resistance to power. In order to continue and accumulate, in order to continue and augment power, you have to exert this power. And that power means inflicting damage, inflicting sabotage, threatening the underlying population. At some point, there's a reaction to that power. Reaction is a passive thing. Occasionally, when you press too hard, you can actually transform the system, and reaction turns into something active, something that actually transmutes the system into something else. And our argument in a nutshell was that towards the 2000, capitalists started to sense that there might emerge this, what we call asymptotic scenario, that power is approaching its peak strength. And from that point onwards, it actually might invert. That resistance to it can become autonomous to some extent and actually change the system. And that is, we argued, was the fundamental basis for the fear of capitalists looking into the future. And the reason is that the processes of modern capitalism are based on capitalization. Capitalization is looking into the future, assessing the future and its impact on present profitability and on present risk perception and all sorts of things that go into the financial quantification of capital. And because you look into the future and the future looks very much more risky and very much more threatening than the present, immediately that gets reflected in asset value. So what we have seen over the past decade or so is a systemic decline in markets. We see some reversion now, but overall, the last 10 years or so have been characterized by what we call a major bear market. And that is, we argue, a reflection of the perception of a future that might look radically different than, say, the past 70 years. So that's the basis of systemic fear. You exert a lot of power. In order to exert more power, in order to accumulate more capital as power, you need to exert more of that power, and at some point something is going to give because of the asymptotic nature of power. It cannot increase forever. And capitalists looking into the future are bringing the future into the present that gets reflected in asset prices, and we get a major bear market as a result. Now, what I'd like to do today is try to explore this asymptotic scenario, to explore the possibility of a systemic crisis and the objective basis that capitalists might consider as the reason for a future radically different than the present. But in order to do so, and this I've learned from giving presentations in the past, I need to spend quite a lot of time situating our own analysis relative to existing analysis, because otherwise you might actually find it difficult to escape the gravitational force of existing frameworks that you have. So try to explain what existing approaches suggest about the crisis, and then give you perhaps some insight into our argument and how it might differ from what you are used to. So the structure of the presentation will be divided into three. The first part, I will deal with the so-called macroeconomic creed. That's the dominant liberal approach. And economists tend to believe that they have solved all the theoretical questions, and the only questions remain to be solved are the how rather than the why. So Milton Friedman is famous for saying that the only difference, say, between monetarists and Keynesians is the elasticities of the various functions. So it's a quantitative difference rather than a difference in principle. So the question that macroeconomic economists presented themselves is, you know, how do we fix this thing? How do we change the nuts and bolts or some of the principles in order for this to actually work properly? The second part deals with the Marxist perspective, and that's very, very different. Marxists understand capitalism as a conflictual system, and therefore the question that Marxists try to address is not how to actually bring about a recovery, but whether a sustained recovery is feasible in the first place. And only then we will get to the theory of capital as power. And there I will raise the question, which is, in my opinion, prior, of whether capitalists can afford recovery, whether they're interested in recovery in the first place, and what does it all mean. So there's quite a lot of steps before we get to the so-called punchline. Okay, so let's begin with the macroeconomic creed. And if you skip to page 3 of your handout, you see a list of quotes. And the title is Systemic Fear. So what I'd like to do with those quotes is give you some sense of the mindset of the ruling class as expressed by policymakers and journalists over the past few years. The first quote is from Alan Greenspan from 2008. Alan Greenspan used to be the head of the Federal Reserve Board in the United States. He was nicknamed the Maestro. I worked at the bank credit analyst in the 1990s as sort of a financial analyst. And back then in the office and around the financial business sector, he was called God. Not God's representative, but God. Now he, in 2008, was appearing before a Congressional Inquisition Committee, and he said, "The whole intellectual edifice collapsed in the summer of last year." And he confided in the committee by saying that himself and people like him were in a state of shock disbelief. Now, this is coming from God. A year later, the editors of the Financial Times, reputedly the most important capitalist daily in the world, write that uncertainty is the only certain thing in this crisis. This is explicitly stated in an editorial, and I'm not going to read the entire text, but you can browse through it. Gillian Tett, ostensibly one of the smartest journalists in the Financial Times, writes, "The pillar of faith on which this new financial capitalism were built have all but collapsed. And that collapse has left everyone from finance minister or central banker to small investor or pension holder bereft of an intellectual compass, dazed and confused." So this is 2009. That's kind of the height of the financial turmoil. But things haven't changed very much over the next 5 years. The last quote is from a gathering of central bankers in Jackson Hole in the US. This is kind of a luxurious resort to which central bankers retreat every year to discuss the problems of the world. And the journalist here summarizes the feeling at the conference and quoting some of the policymakers as stating that they were flying blind when steering their economies and that they are in uncharted territories. In a way, that means that the models do not give them the result they expect, and they rely on quantitative models, and those models seem to not work. Now, these are the people who are supposed to know. And if they express themselves in that way, you can appreciate that they have a serious problem and they are reflecting a mindset of the ruling class at the time. And this is just a year ago. Now, the question is, why this systemic fear? Why is this great anxiety that something is going seriously wrong? In order to begin exploring this objective setup, we'll begin with the first figure. There are plenty of figures, about 16, in your handout, and we'll go through all of them. And I'll try to explain them, and I will ask you to raise questions only in the end. But if you have a technical question about the graph, you can ask me, and I will try to clarify, because I know not everybody is familiar with the graphic presentation, but unfortunately or fortunately, capitalism is a very quantitative system, and that's the language of the capitalists. And if we don't speak the language of the capitalists, it's quite difficult to understand the way they organize their system. So that will be, excuse me. There are plenty of them here. So figure one is a snapshot, something that finance ministers or central bankers would look at to get a sense of what has happened over the past 15 years and what is the situation currently relative to the recent past. And what it gives you is the most general indicator for so-called economic performance. That's the annual growth of the GDP. So every observation here measures the growth of the gross domestic product in so-called real terms, in quantitative terms, relative to the previous year. And there are three categories. The first category is for the advanced countries. The second category is for developing and emerging countries. And the third one is the so-called average. It's for the world as a whole. And we can see here the first crisis of the 2000, which happened between 2000 and 2002. And we see a sort of synchronized decline in growth rates. But that was still not in negative territory. GDP was still growing. There is a recovery all the way towards 2008 in all three categories. And then comes the great decline. A massive drop in the advanced countries. GDP contracted by about 5%. GDP also almost contracted in the developing world, around 0%. And the world as a whole contracted by about 3%. So that was a very, very deep recession. The recovery from that deep recession was pretty brisk, but it was also pretty short. And we can see that the slide is renewed after a year or so. All the indicators point down. We see some increase in the advanced countries. Where I worked at the bank credit analyst, they used to call this a dead cat bounce. You know, if you take a cat and you drop it from a high rise, it goes. That doesn't mean that the cat is alive, right? So the question arises here whether what happened in the last year in the advanced countries is a dead cat bounce, or is it really the beginning of a sustained recovery? And I think that the feeling among the policymakers and the capitalists is that it might be the latter. They are very hopeful. They cross their fingers that this is a serious beginning, but there's great hesitation. And the reason there is a great fear about the future is that this recovery that we see now is, to some extent, coming at the footstep of massive policy intervention. So if that is the most we can get from that massive policy intervention, we might be in trouble. Now, in order to get a sense of how serious the situation is, we need a little bit of theoretical background. Again, I'll try to keep it to the minimum in the beginning. And this is equation one. I think there are several more equations down the road. I'll try to explain them all. It's titled Decomposing GDP. And that equation goes back to David Hume, who is reputed to have invented this so-called classical dichotomy, the argument that the economic sphere is made of two separate realms. The first is the real realm. This is where the real action is situated. This is where utility is enjoyed. This is where productivity is experienced. This is where production takes place. This is when unemployment is suffered, and so on. And then there's the other realm, the nominal realm of prices, of money, of finance, which is not that important. It's mostly a mirror of the real realm. But it's also a lubricant, to some extent, of real economic activity. And this type of decomposition simply, when is translated to contemporary jargon, says that the nominal dollar value of GDP, the gross domestic product, is computed. In fact, it is a product of two components, the real GDP and the nominal price level. If you were able to put everything that is produced in the economy in a particular year in a giant basket, so this is your real GDP, and you multiply that giant basket by the average price of all the little commodities in that basket, you get the price of the basket. It's like going to the supermarket, you have a basket with different things, and you multiply that basket by the average price, say a pound and 20 pence or whatever, and then you have the price of the entire basket. So this is how GDP is computed. Nominal GDP is real GDP times the average price level. And economists around the world do that every day. Now, why do I give you this theoretical bit? Because it's easier to understand how theory develops relative to this equation. Up until the 1930s, the liberal dogma was that policy intervention was unnecessary and, in fact, possibly harmful. It was unnecessary because the real economy, in other words, Q in this equation, or real GDP, was always hovering around its equilibrium full employment value. So if you leave the economy alone, it will always gravitate back to full employment. So that's the self-correcting market, the liberal idea that markets are self-correcting. And therefore, if government intervenes, for example, by lowering the rate of interest or by trying to spend on public works, the only thing that it can do is actually create inflation. Because in practice, the government doesn't go and affect the real economy. It spends money, or it lowers its taxes, or it increases its taxes, or it prints money. It does things in the nominal realm. So it affects nominal GDP, and then the hope is that it can also affect real GDP. The liberals, up until the 1930s, say no. Because the economy is already hovering around full employment. So if you're printing more money, say, or if you're spending on something else, the only thing you can create is inflation. If you're cutting back, you will create deflation, but you don't affect the real economy. And for that reason, there's no point in intervening. You can always cause distortions, but you cannot really help. And parenthetically, Marx was more or less of the same opinion, because for governments to intervene, governments need to tax. And taxes can come only from the surplus. Taxes can come only from capitalists because workers already earn subsisting wages. So you cannot lower the wages less than subsistence. You have to tax the capitalists, and that's going to undermine accumulation. So as far as the capitalists are concerned, it's better to have smaller government. That was the view until the 1930s. Now, the Great Depression shattered that perspective more or less completely. So we have unemployment at around, say in the US, around 20 or 25%, and that was quite obvious to everybody. And we had large chunks of the productive capacity lying idle, and that was obvious. And it was also obvious that the economy didn't fix itself. It wasn't self-correcting. Everybody could see it. It was just not reacting to market signals. The only group of people who could not see it were the economists. Because the theory told them that that was impossible. It was impossible for an economy to get stuck at an unemployment equilibrium. The only equilibrium which was possible was full employment equilibrium. But here we have equilibrium which is less than full employment, 20%, 25% unemployment. And this is where Keynes comes into the picture. Keynes wrote a book in the 1930s called The General Theory, and it was a very famous book. And rightly so. And what he managed to do is persuade his colleagues that the economy can get stuck at less than full employment. That's why he called it the general theory, because a special case is full employment equilibrium. But the general case is just equilibrium, could be less than full employment. And there are many more points of less than full employment than full employment. So that's a general theory. And secondly, he argued that the government can step in and affect, sure, the price level, but can also affect real GDP. So not only can the economy be at less than full employment, the government can fix things. And that was his great achievement, to persuade economists that the government can actually intervene in an effective way in an economy. And that was quite a dramatic change compared to the pre-1930s. And his argument was based on pretty crude psychology. And there are two psychological principles. The first principle was that capitalists act as savers as well as investors. A saver is somebody who earns an income and puts some of it aside. An investor is somebody who takes this income and builds things with it. As savers, capitalists tend to save more and more as capitalism becomes more affluent. And as investors, capitalists tend to invest less and less. So there's a lot of resources that are leaking out of the system in the form of saving, but not enough are drawn back in the form of investing in new capacity. So there's a difference. And that difference creates chronic stagnation. So this is a psychological difference between investors and savers that causes capitalism, as it advances, as it becomes more affluent, to be stagnating. Secondly, there is instability in capitalism that is built in. And the reason is that capitalists invest with an eye to the future. So they have to make investment now based on future expectations. But the future, Keynes says, is not only unknown, it's unknowable. It has an element of novelty. Nobody, including capitalists, know what the future has in store. So capitalists have to make decisions based on gut feeling. And he called that gut feeling the animal instinct. So capitalists behave erratically because their optimism and pessimism depends on many things, but certainly is not objective. And therefore, there's a built-in instability into the investment process, and therefore, this feeds into instability in capitalism. So again, psychology causes capitalism to stagnate over the long haul, but also to be quite unstable. And the solution here is the government. The government can step in and can generate spending to compensate for insufficient investment by capitalists. And the government can also step in and stabilize the system. In other words, the government can save capitalists from their own folly. All right. Now, the record of the Keynesian period is quite consistent with these claims. In this figure, what we show are two very basic measures that capitalists use to understand their world. The first measure is the rate of unemployment. And by the way, this is for the United States. Almost all the charts, well, most of them are for the United States. And the reason being is that the US offers the most systematic and comprehensive data set. It's not because it's the only thing that counts. It's certainly an important part of capitalism, but it's not the only part of capitalism. But unfortunately, I can present here only a partial picture. So this is the United States. So the top part of the chart is the rate of unemployment. It shows you every year what part of the labor force was looking for work but unable to find work. And that's plotted against the right-hand scale. The bottom part of the chart, plotted against the left-hand scale, is the rate of GDP growth. Again, it's real GDP, so that's the quantitative measure of economic activity. And every year, it tells you by how much it grew relative to the previous year. Okay. Now, what we try to do in this chart is to contrast the period before Keynes with the period after Keynes. So the cutoff point is 1946. It's the end of the Second World War. And you see dotted red lines for both the first period and the second period for each of the series, like that, right? Now, these dotted lines represent one standard deviation above and one standard deviation below the average for the period. Those of you who haven't taken statistics, don't worry, you will understand the rest of the presentation even without knowing what a standard deviation is. It's just a statistical measure that tells us about the dispersion of the series. If a series goes like that, it has very little dispersion. If it goes like that, it has a lot of dispersion of volatility. Now, the argument is that under normal circumstances, one standard deviation above and one below the average will contain about two-thirds of the deviations. So we compute that for the period up to 46 and from 46 onwards. And it's quite clear that for both series, the deviations have been compressed significantly, anywhere between two-thirds and three-quarters of the deviation. So government intervention, in a way, has managed to not only prevent another Great Depression, but to reduce the volatility of capitalism quite significantly. And this picture is not unique to the United States. It's actually shared by other experiences, by other countries as well. So Keynesianism, at least from that perspective, managed to save capitalism from some of its most serious shortcomings, or so it seems. Policymakers seem to have managed to have learned how to manage their economies. And in some senses it was a blessing, but in other senses it was a curse. It was exactly a problem for capitalists, because capitalists have been in some sense dethroned. Previously, capitalist confidence was very crucial. So if capitalists are not confident, everybody is being punished. Not anymore. If capitalists do not behave properly, they're not investing enough, or they're investing erratically, governments can move in and fix things. We've seen the record here. So one thing is that capitalists are no longer in the sort of exclusive position in the driver's seat. That's bad enough. But policymakers can step in and do something even worse than that. They can start taxing capitalists. And we've seen that in the United States and elsewhere. We've seen corporate taxation rising significantly after the Second World War, as well as marginal personal tax rates are rising. So capitalists actually fill it in the bottom line. So in a way, it was a blessing in disguise. It saved capitalism, but it threatened capitalists. Conclusion? Well, Keynes has to be undone. And this is where Milton Friedman and the monetarists come into the picture. According to Friedman and the monetarists, the pre-1930s model of liberalism was just about right. It had two glitches, and there were correctable glitches. The first glitch was that it had no notion of the natural rate of unemployment, and the second glitch is that it did not have a clear notion of expectations. So let me try to explain both of these concepts, beginning with the natural rate of unemployment. The natural rate of unemployment is like the emperor's new clothes. It's only the monetarist who can actually see it. Because up until the 1930s, the neoclassicists played according to what you see is what you get. If unemployment, say, is 0.5% or hovering around that level, and any dip is immediately corrected, well, the theory is fine, because the economy is self-correcting. But if unemployment is 25% and stuck there, well, obviously neoclassical or pre-1930s liberalism is not a very useful theory, because it doesn't correspond to reality. So you look at the evidence and you take them at face value. The monetarists said, wait a minute, appearances can be deceiving. The unemployment that you see is not unemployment at all. In fact, most of it is natural. And why is that? Well, we live in a dynamic society. Capitalism is a system that not only grows all the time, it transforms itself all the time. So we have new products, we have new industries, we have new sectors. We have changes that are qualitative and happening all the time. So some sectors are going down while others are rising. What this creates is friction. There's a lot of friction in this system because it's constantly transforming itself. And in that friction, quite a number of people get caught. And they end up being unemployed. But this is temporary unemployment as we move from one form of production and consumption to another form. A lot of people also are constantly searching for unemployment. For employment. So you have a job, and you want a better job. What do? You quit your job. And you are constantly on the internet or on the phone or writing letters, depending on when the theory is written, looking for better jobs. That's what economists call search unemployment. And Edmund Phelps won a Nobel Prize for inventing this idea of search unemployment. So, in fact, most unemployment is not unemployment at all. It's natural, it's desirable, it's useful, and things that are natural, desirable, and useful should not be messed with. So there's no point in trying to reduce unemployment below its natural rate, because it's natural. Now the question is, can unemployment, though, be reduced below its natural rate? And the answer is, yes, it can be, but only by cheating. The government, if unemployment is 8% and the government wants 4, it can do that, but only by cheating us. And this has to do with the nature of economic agents, as neoclassical political economists imagine those agents. If the agents are rational, so they are constantly calculating the options, and if they are fully informed, they have all the information, they will focus only on the so-called real economy. And that will ignore all nominal signals. Everything that has to do with nominal prices, with finance, it will be ignored because that belongs to the nominal side. They will focus on the real side. However, if agents are confused, they're not fully rational, or they're not fully informed, they might misjudge nominal information for real information, and they will make bad decisions. Under those circumstances, governments always have the temptation to cheat us against our own true interest, to lower unemployment. So if we're unemployed, we're going to get a job, and that's obviously bad, but nevertheless, governments have the incentive to do that. Now, the efficacy of cheating depends on expectations. So we talked about the natural rate. Expectations has to do with how agents interpret nominal signals. Now, in Milton Friedman and Edmund Phelps, agents are not fully rational. They're kind of lethargic. They're slow. It takes them time to learn. So they take the signals that they see, prices and nominal variables, and they learn only slowly through those signals about the real economy. You can always cheat them. For example, governments can print a lot of money, and agents will think that the economy is booming in real terms, and therefore offer more jobs, and they will demand more jobs, and then we'll have higher employment, because agents are not fully rational. Now, Friedman said, this can last for a while, but not forever. Eventually, agents will learn, in which case the effect of the policy will dissipate, and we end up with much higher inflation, because government intervene and back with the same level of high unemployment, the natural rate of unemployment. But this can last for 20 years. So Friedman was a good beginning, but not good enough. This is the 1960s, when he comes with this idea of adaptive expectations. In the 1970s come people like Lucas and Sargent, and they say, no, agents are fully rational. You can never cheat them, not even for a moment. So the government can do whatever it likes. The agents see through the policy, and they ignore the policy. So you can never cheat them. You can never actually reduce unemployment below its natural rate. There's no point even in trying. And then in the 1980s, there's the final version of it, or at least the final version I'm aware of, and that's called the real business cycle version. And this is with people like Kidlin and Prescott. These guys said, look, the whole business cycle is a supply-side phenomenon. Government intervenes through the demand side by spending and taxes. There's no link between the two. So there's no point even in trying to cheat people, even for the momentary run. Now these people, Phelps, Friedman, Lucas, Sargent, Kidlin, Prescott, all went on to receive the Nobel Memorial Prize in Economics. And they managed to do so by essentially undoing Keynes. This is what they got the Nobel Prize for. And they produce a Candide-like new dogma that we live in the best of all possible worlds. Unemployment is always natural, whether it's 2% or 20%. And policy is ineffective, and intervention is unnecessary. So we're talking about 1980s, 1990s. This is the beginning of neoliberalism. And it's based on this revival of pre-1930s theories that you shouldn't really mess with the economy. In other words, you shouldn't really mess with the capitalists. This is the situation in 2008. And then the crisis struck, 2008. Some of you were too young to remember. All right. The Great Recession coming after the collapse of the stock market in 2008. The Economist, as far as I know, remained completely unfazed. I tried to list one of my courses after the crisis, to cross-list one of my courses, because I'm teaching in political science at York, and I tried to cross-list it with economics. And the Economist told me no. And I said, why not? And they said, we do things rigorously. And I said, well, you know, the crisis didn't change anything. No. Just we do things rigorously. There was just a wall of refusal. Part of it, of course, is by continuous subsidization of economics. Part of it is by, you know, tenure and so on. Economic theory changed by very little, if at all, following the crisis. But the policymakers responded immediately. They panicked, and they panicked in unison. And they engaged in massive intervention. And I'd like to review very briefly the nature of this intervention. And there are two types of macroeconomic intervention. One is called fiscal intervention that has to do with spending and taxation. And the other has to do with monetary intervention, has to do with printing money and changing the rate of interest. So I'll explore each one of them briefly. So let's begin with the fiscal intervention. This chart shows the government budget balance in the OECD countries. And that's the black line. And you also see the dotted line for Germany and the red line for the US. And it is expressed as a percent of GDP. Now, if the balance is positive, it means the government levies more taxes than it spends. So it actually gets more revenues that it departs with. If the balance is negative, it means the government runs a deficit. And you can see that from the 1990s onwards, with the victory of monetarism and then the catchword of neoliberalism, we see budget deficits declining. So the deficit contracts towards zero. And somewhere around the 2000, it turns into even a small surplus. But after that, the situation inverts. We have the beginning of a major bear market. We have the first crisis of the early 2000s, so budget deficits increase. Then we have 2009, and the budget deficit in the OECD goes to 8% of GDP. And in the United States, which is the bastion of liberalism, in other words, non-intervening governments, it's 13%. So that's massive intervention. Now, this should not be mistaken to a return to Keynesianism, because Keynesianism was not only about large government spending as well as large taxation, it was also about some form of planning. Although Keynes was not talking about it, in practice, that's what happened. Government intervention involves some sort of planning. That's not what we see here. Here it's quick and dirty Keynesianism. Essentially, it's tax cuts. So governments are panicking given the depth of the recession, and they are cutting taxes very, very heavily. But we see that the cuts are very short. Some of you may remember at that period of time, 2010, 11, and so on, governments started to talk about austerity and the need to tighten our belts. Not theirs, but ours. And about fiscal cliffs in the US that we are just about to drop into the abyss. And you can see that the deficits are reverting and they are contracting. Governments are contracting the scale of their intervention. And why do they do that? Well, the next chart shows us the thought process of any government policymaker. When you spend more than you tax, the only way to do it is by borrowing money. So you tax X, you spend X plus something, the difference has to be financed by borrowing. As you borrow, what happens is that the government debt increases. We see the government debt in the OECD collection of countries was about 40% in the 1970s. This rose to about 75% in the early 2000s. But in just a few years, it soared to over 110%. So governments are now feeling that they have no longer any ammunition to fire this locomotive called fiscal policy, because the only way to run deficits is to borrow more. And now they are at 110% compared to about 40%. So their hands are tied, so they say. So that's the fiscal side. And that's why they are seriously concerned about the future. Now, the situation from the viewpoint of monetary policy seemed to be equally demoralizing. Up until 2008, the dogma spoke about policy rules as far as monetary policy is concerned. You might have not heard this term. I will explain it. It's a central term for monetary policy. The argument is as follows. If you expect the economy to grow over the next 10 years by 2% annually on average, sometimes 1%, sometimes 3%, but on average 2%, and you want price stability as a central banker, you will expand the money supply by 2%. Sometimes the economy is going to grow at less than 2%, you have some inflation. Sometimes it will grow at more than 2%, you have some deflation. But on average, you have price stability. That's a monetary rule. You don't try to fiddle with the economy. You don't try to anticipate the future in every twist and turn. You just project the long term and then hands off. Just a machine that amplifies the money supply by 2% a year. You want 2% inflation, you make money grow at the rate of GDP growth, 2%, plus another 2%, so you have 4%. 4% growth of money versus 2% growth of the economy, you have 2% inflation. So that's a monetary rule. The idea is that policymakers are like automatons. They feed the information into the machine, and the machine generates the expansion of the money supply. This way, you have no problems. Now, there's a lot of debate and theorizing behind it, but that's basically the practical recommendation. And that's what happened more or less up until 2009. And then whole hell broke loose. What we can see here is what came to be known as quantitative easing, or in simple words, printing money. This is the monetary base. The monetary base is just the measure of how much or how many notes and coins are in the economy at any particular point in time. The government affects the rate of interest and the amount of money by printing money as well as by relying on that amount of money generating an expansion of the credit system, which is private. But the thing that governments can control directly is only the number or the quantity of notes and coin in circulation, and that's what is measured in this graph. So this is just the so-called monetary base, M0. Now we can see that up until 2009, governments in general in the US, the EU, to some extent in Japan, follow a more or less strict policy rule. They kind of expanded the money supply in a stable fashion. But since then, things have changed. In the US, the money supply rose by a factor of almost 5. So they increased the amount of notes and coins tremendously, something that was unthinkable up until that point. The Japanese have remained hesitant up until recently. In 2013, they have embarked on the same policy. And they doubled the money supply since then. And again, this is unprecedented. The EU has been much more hesitant because of the history of hyperinflation in the 1920s and the massive destabilization that was resulting from that money printing. But nevertheless, the EU still manipulated the money supply. So this is a complete breakup of the idea of monetary rule that dominated thinking for much of the 1970s, 1980s, and 1990s. And the fascinating thing about it is that it made almost no difference. That it was like running on empty. If you look at the rate of inflation over the past decade or so, and just what economists call core inflation, and that's inflation without energy and without food, because energy and food are quite volatile, it's been very stable. The argument of the monetarist, if you print too much money, you will have inflation. If you multiply the amount of money by a factor of 5, you're going to have hyperinflation. No. Inflation remained between 1 and 2% in the OECD countries over the past decade. So it had no impact on inflation. That's from the monetary perspective. Now, the Keynesians expected this massive intervention to actually boost investment. And the argument is quite simple. Capitalists invest because they expect a normal rate of return in the future, say 5%. If the rate of interest is 5%, there's no point in borrowing at 5% and investing at 5%. However, if governments reduce the rate of interest, then there's a difference. You borrow at 2%, you invest at 5%, there's a 3% difference. So the argument is, by printing a lot of money, you will reduce the rate of interest. Somehow you will revive investment. Well, that hasn't happened. The rate of investment out of GDP in the OECD countries in 1970 was 25%. So about a quarter of the GDP went to investment. At the eve of the crisis in 2007, it was about 21%. And now it's about 18%. So it's been going down, quite regardless of what government policy was. And actually, it's not that surprising if you look at this next chart, figure 6. In order to revive investment, you have to lower the rate of interest. But what happens if the rate of interest is already close to zero? This is what Keynes called pushing on a string. Put a string on the table and try to push it. You're not going to be able to push it, right? It's the same thing here. If you want to reduce the rate of interest by printing money when the rate of interest is already close to zero, you will be pushing on a string. So all this printing of money goes to the stock market, to the bond market. This is why markets are booming in the financial realm, but investment is not being revived. Now, this brief discussion of fiscal policy and monetary policy perhaps serves to explain why the ruling class feels bereft of an intellectual compass and why the policymakers feel that they are flying blind when steering their economies. Not only has the dogma been abandoned by policymakers, not only has the policy failed to achieve the stated goals, but also policymakers are running out of ammunition. They have a huge budget deficit and a huge accumulated debt. And also they have printed so much money, they're thinking of printing even more. So looking into the future, if there is another crisis of the magnitude of 2008-09, they are pretty much empty-handed. So that's more or less why there is this nagging feeling that we are in deep trouble from the viewpoint of conventional macroeconomics. Now, let's move to the Marxist perspective. The questions that Marxists are trying to answer is not how to bring a recovery, but whether a recovery is possible in the first place. And the short answer is that a sustained recovery is not possible in the Marxist framework. And the gist of the answer, to simplify a lot, is quite simple because accumulation is a conflictual process. It's based on exploitation of workers by capitalists. And this conflict creates instability, it breeds repeated crisis, and eventually, the hopeful's hope, the breakdown of capitalism. Now, Marx has not offered us a complete theory of crisis and a coherent one. Nevertheless, it did offer a number of important key principles that generated in due course a huge literature, a huge Marxist literature of crisis. Now, of course, I cannot do justice to this literature here, but I'll try to highlight some of the principles that Marx and the Marxists have developed and generate some insights from those principles and perhaps explore some of the difficulties they raise. And I will speak about three distinct theories. First is the tendency of the rate of profit to fall. The second is the impact of the reserve army of the unemployed. And the third one is the theory of underconsumption. And let's begin with the tendency of the rate of profit to fall. According to Marx, if we take capitalists as a class, they can only invest what they earn in profit. So the maximum amount of investment is the maximum amount of profit that you have. Some of the profit can be consumed, and therefore you can invest less than the amount of profit, but you can never invest more than the amount of profit. And therefore, if there is a tendency of the rate of profit to fall, there must be a tendency of the rate of accumulation to fall, because if you invest less, then capital will accumulate at a lower rate. Now, in order to understand this principle, perhaps a very quick brush of Marxist accounting. I'm sure some of you know this accounting better than I, but just to put everybody at the same level, very quickly. Okay? The first three equations or definitions say that C is constant capital. Constant capital is the amount that capital is spent on already produced goods and services. And it's constant because Marx argues that that capital cannot generate surplus value. The second measure is called V, and that's variable capital. That's the amount that capital is spent on live labor power. And labor power can generate surplus value. That's why it's called variable capital, because its size can vary by creating something new. And surplus value is what capitalists take from the workers that created this extra. Now, equation 1, 2, and 3 in Marx are measured in what Marx called socially necessary abstract labor time. So they are measured in units of labor time. Now, what Marx says is, look, we can derive three important ratios from these definitions, and we can relate them to show that they're all interlinked. And with that architecture, we can say something about the long-term tendencies of capitalism. So this accounting is not for its own sake, it's for the sake of drawing some conclusions about the fate of the system we live in. The first ratio that he spoke was the organic composition of capital, is the amount of constant capital that capitalists spend on buying already produced goods and services, mostly capital goods, relative to the amount they spend on live labor. And it's called the organic composition of capital, and there's some measure of mechanization. As capitalists mechanize, they will spend more on machines and already finished goods as opposed to live labor. So instead of having a lot of people working by hands, you have fewer people working with machines. Secondly, the rate of surplus value, or the rate of exploitation, is the ratio of the surplus value that capitalists take from the workers relative to the amount they spend on those workers. And finally, the rate of profit is what capitalists take in surplus value relative to what they invest, and that's the constant capital plus the variable capital. So they spend on machines plus workers, and then they earn from that the surplus value. Now, if you were to take equation 6 and divide the numerator and the denominator by V, what you will get is the rate of profit expressed in terms of the other two ratios. So the rate of profit is just the ratio of the rate of surplus value, the rate of exploitation, and the organic composition plus 1. That's just very simple arithmetic. So we're already in equation 7, and we solved all the accounting problems that we need to solve for this presentation. Now, what Marx is saying to us is quite simple if we reduce it to first principle. He says capitalists are competing with one another. And in order to compete, or the nature of competition is constantly striving to make more profit. And one way of doing it is by mechanizing your production. If you're more mechanized, perhaps you're going to be more profitable than your competitors. So each capitalist is trying to mechanize as much as they can. And by mechanizing, they are increasing the organic composition. But you see, in this equation, if you increase the organic composition, you reduce the rate of profit. Now, capitalists, at the same time, are trying to exploit workers more. They're trying to get from workers more than they actually give workers in terms of wages. So they're trying to increase the rate of surplus value, or rate of exploitation. If they succeed in doing so, they raise the rate of profit. So what he's saying is that the nature of competition in capitalism drives capitalists to increase the organic composition, and therefore they're shooting themselves in the foot, although they have no other choice, but that's the effect of it, which will reduce the rate of profit. At the same time, they try to exploit workers more, which will increase the rate of profit. So there are two tendencies, and the question is, which tendency is stronger? Now, Marx argues, although he never managed to completely convince himself by that claim and tried till his death to actually prove it to himself logically, that the organic composition is going to be stronger, that the tendency of mechanization is going to overwhelm, over the very long run, the tendency for more exploitation. So eventually, the denominator is going to rise faster than the numerator, the rate of profit is going to decline, the rate of accumulation is going to decline, and capitalism is going to slide into a terminal crisis. All right. Now, the problems with this argument are legion, and we have written on it in our book, Capital as Power, in chapters 6 and 7, if you're interested. But here I'll try to just outline some problems and try to illustrate them. The first problem is that labor values are not observable. We measure things in capitalism in price terms, but labor values are in hours of socially necessary abstract labor, and the The sad fact is that Marxists have been unable to actually develop an accounting system based on labor value. So this is a serious problem of actually testing this theory, because we have to use a proxy, and the proxy might be completely irrelevant, and we will never know, because we cannot observe socially necessary abstract labor. The second problem is that Marx associates the organic composition with mechanization. The idea is that if you invest more in machines, the organic composition of capital is going to rise. That's not necessarily the case. Because if technology improves, you might be able to cheapen means of production very rapidly, as opposed to the price of labor power, in which case the organic composition is going to actually decline rather than rise. So mechanization itself is not necessarily a factor that will increase the organic composition. Last but not least, all of this framework is focusing on a division that Marx and Marxists make between productive and unproductive economic activity. Productive activity is where surplus value is generated, whereas unproductive activity is something that absorbs surplus value. And unfortunately, there is no objective yardstick to decide which activity is productive and which activity is not. And that's quite important, because one of them creates surplus value and one of them uses surplus value. So we have very serious problems in actually operationalizing this framework, but let's try to do something with it and to perhaps shed some light on the problems that might emerge. The first attempt is in figure 7. And we call this a naive Marxist view, because we actually do not follow the Marxist principle to the letter here. We're assuming, for argument's sake, that there's no division between productive and unproductive activity, that all activity is productive. And again, this is not what Marxists do. And we are measuring here the rate of profit and compare it to the organic composition of capital, assuming that prices reflect labor values and that all activity is productive. So the rate of profit is measured by simply taking all of the net national product, subtracting from it wages, which are presumably equivalent to the value of labor power. We get the surplus value, and we divide that by the amount of fixed assets and what is paid to workers. So that's what capitalists invest, and that gives us the rate of profit. The organic composition of capital is just the total amount of fixed assets in dollar terms divided by labor income. And what we see is the following. We see, first of all, that the two indices are inversely correlated, which is certainly consistent with Marx. We also see here that the rate of profit is declining over time, and is certainly declining in the recent period since the 2000. So the two things are inversely correlated. The rate of profit is declining, but the nagging problem is that the rate of profit should be declining because the organic composition is rising. But what we see here is that the organic composition of capital actually is declining over the long term rather than rising. Now, a Marxist would rightly say, well, that's actually a hoax, because you don't take account of productive versus unproductive activity. So let's examine the second figure 8, which actually tries to do that. Now, as I said, Marxists do not have a very clear yardstick for productive and unproductive activity. So, say, take IBM. Some of the activity of IBM personnel is accounting, say. Is this productive or unproductive? Well, it's hard to tell. So Marxists, instead of trying to identify every activity as productive or unproductive, say, well, let's take a shortcut. Let's say, identify certain industries that are productive and classify all other industries as unproductive. Typically, they will take manufacturing, mining, agriculture, and
transport.
No, not transport. Agriculture and again, mining, manufacturing, agriculture, something else.
Construction,
right. There's a fifth one, and that's utilities. But utilities in the United States present a serious data problem, so unfortunately it is typically dropped from the analysis because of data problems. But they take those five and say, well, these are clearly productive, the rest are ambivalent, so let's ignore them. Now, You take those five sectors, you treat them as productive, and you say they generate all the surplus value in the economy. So using this framework, what you do is you change the computation. The rate of profit is surplus value, and what surplus value is the total net national product less the wages just in those productive sectors. Because all the rest gets absorbed by some of the unproductive sectors. And you divide that by the productive assets, in other words, the assets of those four sectors plus the wages in those four sectors. And the organic composition, again, is the organic composition just in the productive sector. So just those four sectors, the one of which I've forgotten, divided by the productive wages. Now here what we see again, short-term inverse correlation, which is what you would expect, and we see that the organic composition is rising, exactly as Marx claimed. However, the rate of profit, instead of declining, is rising as well. So we have a problem here too. How do we sort out this problem? So these are some of the issues that are quite ambiguous, I think, in the Marxist analysis, and they do not give us a very clear picture of crisis analysis. Let's move from here to the second theory, the reserve army of the unemployed. Marx argued that the reserve army of the unemployed, and I hope none of you belong to that reserve army, but maybe some of you are members of that army or will be in the future, unfortunately, that this has a regulatory impact on capitalist activity. It makes sure that the wage rate gravitates towards its true value. So workers receive a wage that is proportionate to the value of labor power. If there is a boom, workers raise their head because there's a great demand for labor power, and the wages will move above their subsistence, their true value. But then capitalists will strike back. Because the rise in the wage rate is too high, that will harm profitability. Capitalists will cut back. There will be a crisis, and the automaticity of the crisis will inflate again. The reserve army of unemployed wages will gravitate back to their subsistence level. So this is a very important built-in mechanism in capitalism to ascertain that workers receive their true value. Now let's examine the first of two charts that tries to examine this process. And here, this is for the US. What we plot here is the rate of unemployment, which is the size of the reserve army of the unemployed. And we compare that with the rate of change of the real wage. So the rate of change of the real wage is taking the real wage and measuring by how much it changes in percent term from 1 year to the next. But there's a trick here in the chart, because remember, the unemployment should be inversely correlated with the wage rate. The higher the unemployment, the lower the wage rate. So I'm inverting here on the left-hand scale the scale for the rate of change of the real wage. It starts from plus 10 and goes all the way up to minus 8. So when you see a decline in the series for the rate of change of the real wage, in fact, it is an increase in the series. Now what we see here is a remarkable negative correlation. Every time the unemployment rate increases, the rate of change of the real wage decreases. And we can see interesting process happening in the run-up to the current crisis. We see unemployment moving down and the real wage accelerating in the run-up for the crisis. So by the year 2000, the real wage accelerated to a growth of about 3%, up from a growth of only 0.5%. So you can interpret this crisis, this rise in unemployment, as an automatic sort of backlash of capitalism against workers, because wages are rising too fast, unemployment increases, it inflates the reserve army of the unemployed and harms wages, so wages decelerate. Now, whether this was the trigger for the crisis is quite impossible to tell, but certainly it's consistent, or seems consistent, with Marx's notion of the role of the reserve army and the automatic mechanism in this recent crisis. But Marx did not speak about the rate of change of the wage rate. He spoke about the level of the wage rate. And here, the picture is actually quite different. Here, we are measuring the rate of unemployment against the right-hand scale. And I forgot to mention that in the previous chart, the rate of unemployment was smooth as a moving average. Here, it's the actual level year after year. And we have two series for the level of the real wage. One is only in manufacturing, that's a thick line. And the other is in the entire business sector, less farming. Now here we see a different picture. Up until 45 or so, the relationship is inverse. So when unemployment declines from the peak of the Great Depression, we see a rise in wages. And when there is an increase in unemployment, we see some decline in wages. But from 1945 onwards, the relationship seems to break down. We see unemployment rising, and the real wage, instead of falling, is rising with it. And when unemployment levels off, the real wage, instead of soaring, levels off with it. So again, it's hard to claim, based on this chart, that somehow this crisis has to do with the reserve army of the unemployed. This maybe belongs to the 19th century, but in the 20th century, it's much more difficult to make heads or tail in this theory, at least in the United States. So let's move to the third and final argument of the Marxists that has to do with underconsumption. And let me speak a little bit about underconsumption before going into the chart. The theory of the tendency of the rate of profit to fall, and to some extent the reserve army of the unemployed argument, is associated with the production side, the ability of capitalists to produce surplus. But there's another argument that has to do with the realization of the surplus, the ability to absorb that surplus, the ability to purchase that surplus. And a realization crisis as opposed to a productive crisis is quite different. And let me try to very, very briefly explain the basic principle underlying the theory of underconsumption. Workers tend to consume all of their income. Now, I assume that most of you earn your living from one form of wage or another, and most of you spend all of your income. And if you don't, you save it, usually in order to spend it on some consumption items in the near future. So the share of consumption out of your income is more or less one. And that's true for most workers. In the United States, for example, only the top 20% of the population save anything. The capitalists behave quite differently. Most of the income is actually not consumed. It's actually saved. And that's partly because they can afford it, because usually they are better off. But most importantly, because the social role compels them to invest rather than to consume. If a capitalist consumes all his or her income, the end result is that he or she will cease to be a capitalist. So there's a fundamental difference between the behavior of workers and the behavior of capitalists as far as consumption out of income is concerned. Now imagine that there is an upward redistribution of income. So some of your income goes to capitalists. So the average share of consumption out of national income will decline because the income will be shifted from people who spend it all to people who spend only part of it. So the average share of income going to consumption will decline. When that happens, redistribution generates a problem. Upward redistribution actually cuts consumption, and it generates a realization problem. The surplus cannot be purchased because there's not enough demand for it. So consumption, there's underconsumption. Underconsumption causes a glut. Profits are declining. Prices are declining. Soon enough, capitalists feel the pinch, and they will invest less. So there is a general realization crisis. Now, the history of underconsumption and realization crisis is a little rocky as far as Marxists are concerned. Up until the early 20th century, most Marxists viewed underconsumption theory with great suspicion, partly because Marx was quite ambivalent about it, as opposed to the tendency of the rate of profit to fall. But with the early 20th century, the sentiment changed quite a bit. First, there was a massive explosion of imperialism during the latter part of the 19th century. Then came the Great Depression of the 30s, and then came the militarized boom of the 1940s. Now, with the writing of John Hobson in the beginning of the 20th century about the role of underconsumption in the drive to imperialism, there was not enough consumption in Britain and some of the other European countries, and that's why there was a movement towards the outside of the center. And with the work of Keynes on effective demand, the view of Marxists started to change. And they took more seriously the idea that underconsumption could be very important in generating capitalist crisis. And one of the most innovative contributors to this literature was the Polish political economist Michael Kalecki. Kalecki wrote in the 1930s and 1940s, and he developed a class-based micro-macro model that was terribly innovative at the time. I thought it was quite ingenious. And what he did was to anticipate Keynes's general theory, and for that reason, Keynes is reputed to refuse him entry into Cambridge. He can only go to Oxford. But also it exceeded Keynes in a certain important way. It exceeded Keynes because he introduced the structure of power into the macroeconomic model, something that Keynes never dare even think about. And he argued that the structure of power affects distribution and therefore affects the performance of the economy. And he called that the degree of monopoly. The idea was that the degree of monopoly is some measure of the ability of capitalists to take a larger share of the national income. The greater the degree of monopoly, the greater the share of capitalists in national income. And that, of course, reduces the share of consumption in national income, as we suggested, and therefore generates the possibility of a realization crisis. So what he's saying, essentially, Kalecki, is that you need to look at the structure of power in the market in order to understand the macroeconomic performance. And that's very un-Keynesian, because Keynes tries to abstract from the underlying micro and just look at the macro. And Kalecki says no. Now, this argument gave rise to a new theory. Maybe some of you heard of it. Is the theory of monopoly capital that developed in the United States with Paul Baran and Paul Sweezy and Monthly Review, which became quite popular after the Second World War. Now, we can try to generalize Kalecki and the monopoly capital school by saying, let's look at the distribution of income, not only between capitalists and workers, which is what Kalecki focused about, but let's look at the distribution of income in general, regardless of the source of that income. And this we do in this chart. So the bottom of this chart looks at the income share of the top 1%. This comes from the work of Thomas Piketty and his colleagues. And the data here are smooth. There's 10-year moving averages, so you can see the trend. And the top of the chart shows you the rate of employment growth, which is an index of the performance of the economy. And we don't use GDP growth, because GDP growth is made of two components. It's made of productivity growth, which has really nothing to do with the overall level of activity, and employment growth. We are really interested in employment growth. Now, this is quite a stunning picture, I think. We see here three periods. We see the Gilded Age up until the 1930s. And this is a period in which income inequality is rising. So capitalists are appropriating a larger share of the income. And employment growth is decelerating rapidly. Then we see the post-war Keynesian period of the welfare-warfare state. This is a period of great moderation of inequality. Inequality is actually falling dramatically up until the 80s. And what we see is that employment growth is accelerating significantly. We can also see a major spike with the Second World War and then a major decline in employment growth due to mobilization and demobilization because of the war. But the general trend is upwards. And of course, from 1980s onwards, we see the victory of monetarism and what came to be known as neoliberalism. And that means a massive acceleration of income inequality and a massive deceleration of employment growth. The numbers we see recently is 20% appropriated by the top 1%, and unemployment growth of about zero, slightly more than that. And these are numbers that are equivalent to what we, or the United States, saw in the 1930s. So this is the dismal situation now. Now, from the perspective of an under-consumptionist, the situation looking forward has sort of two possibilities. Either we are going to go in the direction of the post-war era, so massive increases in equalization, inequality is declining, and more jobs, and all of you are going to have to choose between five different jobs. And the alternative is that the capitalists are not going to give an inch, and the situation is going to linger, maybe intensify, become more serious, and who knows what kind of an explosion can come out of that. So this is pretty consistent with the Marxist notion, I think, of underconsumption. However, so far, we did not say anything about the nature of the crisis in a fundamental way. We described the crisis without ever asking, what is a crisis? Because maybe a crisis is not the same thing for everybody. So the conventional viewpoint is that the engine of capitalism is the economy. And the twin pistons are the accumulation of capital on the one hand and economic growth on the other hand. So as the capitalists accumulate more capital, they fuel economic growth. As economic growth increases, there's more capital accumulation. And both of these are measured in real terms. So you measure everything in real categories. And under those circumstances, what is a crisis? Well, when accumulation breaks down and when economic growth breaks down. So these are economic categories. And this is what we see in this chart here. This chart, again, is for the United States. The bottom line shows you the expansion of the GDP in absolute levels and the expansion of the fixed capital stock in absolute levels. So one is GDP and the other is capital, according to the conventional creed. And the top line shows you the rates of growth. So if you start, say, from the 1960s, you see that both of these, the fixed assets, which is the capital stock, and GDP are decelerating. Growth rates are becoming smaller and smaller. And from this perspective, the current crisis is just the culmination of a massive deceleration that started, you know, many decades ago and now coming to a head. And it's certainly consistent with the Marxist notion of a class struggle, which somehow disturbs the ability of capitalism to generate sustained growth. But, and here we come to the nagging problem, and that is that if you look at this problem, or this question, or this chart from the viewpoint of capitalists and workers, what are they trying to achieve? From an economic point of view, they're both trying to get more in real terms. So workers want higher wages in real terms to consume more, and capitalists want higher incomes in order to invest more and eventually consume more. So both of them are essentially on the same side of the fence. Both of them want the economy to prosper because prosperity serves both their interests. And we see that in the next chart, which measures GDP growth as well as the growth of pre-tax profit and the growth of wages. And we see they correlate quite tightly with each other. So when the economy decelerates, the income of capitalists decelerates and the income of workers decelerate. So they are essentially in the same boat. For them, for both sides, if we are going to have an expansion, that is going to be a good thing. So although you might be deeply anti-capitalist if you're a worker, still you share an interest with capitalists in terms of wanting to have growth. Of course, there's a massive difference between Marxists and liberals in the sense that both of them, they give very different reasons for the crisis. For the liberals, it's distortions that somehow screw up the economy. And for Marxists, it's built-in conflict. And they have different solutions. Liberals argue for deregulation, and Marxists argue that perhaps there is no solution. But both of them view crisis in real terms, and both of them view crisis in terms of productivity, in terms of utility, in terms of actual real production. And this is, I think, where we can finally come to our own approach that argues perhaps we can use completely different spectacles to understand the fundamental difference between how capitalists view the crisis and how workers view the crisis. And this is from the viewpoint of capital as power. The difference is that we do not, from the viewpoint of capital as power, do not think of capital as an economic entity. We think about it as a power institution. And we do, therefore do not think of the crisis as an economic crisis of production and consumption, but as a crisis of capitalized power. Now, what do we mean by capitalized power and capitalist power more generally? Well, here I have to condense 30 years of thinking into about 2 minutes or 1 minute, which will be quite difficult, but nonetheless, I'll do it. The watershed is perhaps Johann Kepler. In 1600, Kepler changed our vision of force and power dramatically. Up until that point, power was and force were thought of as standalone qualitative entities. So power was an entity just like earth or fire. And it was qualitative. It wasn't measured in quantitative terms. Kepler said, no, power and force are relations between entities. And they are quantitative relationships. We have to think of force in quantitative terms relating different entities. Now, if you take this idea, this scientific notion of power and force, and impose it on capitalism, then the greed of distribution, the distribution of income, the distribution of assets between owners. Owners are the entities. Distribution is the quantitative relationship between owners. So the greed of distribution is the greed of power in society. And that greed of power tells us about the relationship between capitalists and other groups in society, other classes in society, as well as between capitalists themselves. And taking this idea in its most general way, in the 1990s, we ask ourselves, what might be a way to describe a regime of accumulation? And we said, well, a regime of accumulation, a sustained regime of accumulation, has to have at least two conditions fulfilled. The first condition is that differential accumulation has to be non-negative. Differential accumulation means the rate at which dominant capital, these are the largest capitalist group at the center of the political economy, the rate at which they accumulate relative to the average. So these groups must become bigger relative to the average over time, or at least not decline relative to the average. And that will satisfy the drive for more power, because we argue that in capitalism, the idea is not to obtain maximum accumulation, it's to obtain differential accumulation, to beat the average, to be better than others. The second condition was that the share of capitalists in national income is going to be stable or rising. And the reason why it has to be stable or rising is that if it is falling, actually the very nature of capitalism will be put into question. If the share of capitalists in national income declines gradually, well, something very important is happening that moves us away from capitalism. So these are the two conditions that we said will be necessary as minimum conditions. And on that basis, we argue that the capitalist crisis is a violation of these conditions. So let's try to have a look at what happened in the United States, looking at these two conditions. Okay, so what this figure measures is what economists call EBIT. EBIT stands for earnings before interest and taxes. So that's pre-tax profit plus interest. That will be capitalist income. The top of the series measures the share of capitalists in national income. And what we see as a very general observation is that this share is rising. So it was about 12% in the 1930s and 40s, and nowadays it's about 16%. So that's an increase of about one third. Also, there's a sense here in this measure that the volatility of this share of capital in national income is declining over time. And if volatility is some indication of risk, capitalists are facing declining risk, apparently, even though their share of national income is rising. which is counterintuitive to the claim of finance that, you know, the higher the return, the greater the risk. Here we see that you have higher returns power-wise, but also lower risk. The second line in this figure at the bottom shows differential capital income, capitalist income. And what this measure tries to approximate is the ratio of the top firms to the average. So if you take all the firms in the US and you list them, all firms incorporated in the US, and you list them by size, and you take only the top 200, and you measure their average EBIT, and you compare that to the overall average EBIT, you get the series. And that will tell you that in 1950, a top 200 firm was about 900 times bigger than the average. Currently, it's about 14,000 times bigger than the average. So there's been a tremendous increase in the size of dominant capital in the center of the political economy. It's about 4.5% a year increase. And that sort of parallels also the increase that we see in capitalist income share. So I basically plot here the conventional creed of real economic activity, the real growth of GDP, the real growth of income of workers, the real growth of income of capitalists, and it's decelerating. So this is the sense of a lingering crisis that we have. But if you compare that to the power perspective, it's quite different. From the viewpoint of capitalists, their power is rising in general, and the power of dominant capital, the large capitalists at the center, is rising as well. So this is quite different when you compare these two views. All right. Now let's begin with the bottom of the chart. This is a logarithmic scale on the right. Logarithmic scale is a very funny scale. It rises in jumps. So it rises from 500 to 1,000, to 1,000 to 2,000, to 4,000, 6,000, and so on, to 8,000. So it doubles every time, every jump. So changes in this chart are not very striking visually, but nevertheless, in quantitative terms, they're quite important. We see in the 1980s a drop here. And we see another drop here. This is 20% in the 1980s. So differential accumulation decelerated by 20% in the 1980s, and it decelerated by 30% recently. So these are potential crises that we see in those different periods. There is a significant difference, though, between the crisis in the 80s and the crisis currently. First of all, during the 80s, the size of capital in national income increased despite the decline of dominant capital. That's not the situation now. Here we see a decline in the capital share of income as well as a decline in dominant capital. But there is a much larger challenge that capitalists can think of. Imagine that we are here in the 1950s. Increasing the size of dominant capital from 900 to 1800 is quite easy. Compared to increase, so that's doubling. Compared to increasing the size of dominant capital from 14,000 to 28,000. Most of this increase is because of mergers and acquisitions. If we are to continue and see this exponential growth, the size of mergers and acquisitions has to recalibrate to the size of capital. But now the size of big capitalist or big capitalist organization is 14 times bigger than it was. Sorry, 17 times bigger than it was in the 1950s. So mergers and acquisitions have to be 17 times bigger now than in the 50s in order to just keep the pace of this increase. So it becomes much more difficult now for dominant capital to expand. And we see that in the news every day that we open the Financial Times, that it's very hard to engage in very large mergers and acquisitions now nowadays. So that's one very serious challenge that dominant capitalists are now facing, increasing differential accumulation even further. The alternative is to increase differential profit margins. And again, this is a very tall order for dominant capital at this point. Now, can capitalists expand the share that they have in national income in general? So if the overall share of capital and national income is going to increase, dominant capitalists will have more room to absorb, swallow smaller capitalists. Is that possible? And that brings us to the end of the presentation. We'll move to the figure 15 here. Now, figure 15 should be quite counterintuitive to most of you, regardless of whether you are liberal or Marxist in your orientation. What we see here is a comparison or a superimposition of two series. One is the unemployment rate, and the other is the share of capitalists in the form of pre-tax profit and net interest in domestic income. Now, there's a little complication here in the data that the unemployment rate is lagged 3 years. It means that every observation of the unemployment is the unemployment rate prevailing 3 years earlier. The top part of the chart shows you the level. So it shows you the level of unemployment relative to the share of capitalists in domestic income. The bottom part of the chart shows you the rate of change of these two series. Now, this is quite remarkable because intuitively you would expect as unemployment increases, capitalists are going to suffer. They're going to see their share of national income declining. But that's not what we see here. We see here, both in the short term and in the long term, that the share of capital and national income benefits from higher unemployment. It doesn't suffer from higher unemployment. It's the exact opposite. So the higher the unemployment rate, the better off capitalists are doing in terms of their distributive share. The next chart shows you the same relationship, but instead of plotting this relationship against time, it plots the relationship between the two variables. So on the horizontal axis, we see the unemployment rate 3 years earlier. And on the vertical axis, we see the share of capital in domestic income. So that's kind of a functional relationship, quote unquote. Now, I have here two statistics. One is the slope, and the other is the so-called R squared. The R squared is a measure of fit, and it's 0.82. It means, in simple language, that 82% of the squared variations of the pre-tax profit and net interest in national income is explained by unemployment. If you know unemployment, you know 82% of the changes in the share of capitalists. So capitalists coming and sitting here can be quite satisfied with having a very simple predictor of their share of national income just looking at unemployment 3 years earlier. This also tells you exactly by how much the share of capital and national income is going to change with every percent change of unemployment. If unemployment changes in 1%, 3 years later, the share of capitalists in national income will be 0.8% higher. Now, if we scroll back to the previous chart, what you see, the kind of sophisticated thing about this relationship is that you can see unemployment is rising, has been rising 3 years earlier, but we are projecting the data forward. So capitalists have quite a run on their share of national income. They can see it rising in the years ahead. Now, this is quite remarkable because Marx was prescient in understanding the role of unemployment in disciplining workers. But he spoke mostly about the very short term towards the peak of the cycle, that you have to punish workers for having higher wages by inflating unemployment and reducing their expectations and ability to generate those wages. But here we see a long-term trend. We see capitalist share of national income is rising along with the stagnation of the economy, along with unemployment. So this is a long-term relationship as well as a short-term relationship. Now, the implications, I think, are quite significant here. Not only has the dogma of the mainstream economist collapsed in a certain important way, not only have policymakers lost most of the ammunition that they had to fix things up, but here we are saying something rather different. We are saying that the very goals of policy are contradictory, because the basic idea with the mainstream view is that the tide lifts all boats. And you have a tide of growth and a tide of capital accumulation. And capitalists, of course, are going to gain tremendously, but it's going to lift all of us with it. And policymakers, catering to the capitalist, also somehow are catering to our interests. Well, here we argue something quite different. We're arguing that by lifting the capitalist boat, policymakers have to almost by definition, sink our boats. Because the only way for them to lift the capitalist boat, if you see it from the viewpoint of power, is by sustaining high levels of unemployment. Now, what lies ahead? Well, we see this massive increase in the share of capitalists. And the question is, can this be pushed further? Remember, capitalists have no choice. If they are driven to beat the average, if they're constantly driven to increase their share of the total, and if this relationship is valid, in other words, if they need to inflict sabotage on society in order to do that, because that's the nature of power. Power is about taming the other, about sabotaging, undermining the other. If you need to do that, if you need to raise unemployment further and further, it means that the entire process is a double-edged sword. Capitalists need a crisis. They need a constant threat. They need a constant infliction of power. But at the same time, they know that this is threatening them. Because at some point, there could be a serious backlash. The question is, you know, how much can you push further and further? And this, we argue, is the underpinning, the serious underpinning of the current systemic crisis. Because we are hovering here around some peak levels. We're hovering here around some peak levels. And we are hovering here around some peak levels. So, you know, how much further can you push? And that's why capitalists are very, very nervous about the future, because they have no choice. They cannot just stop and say, well, we have enough power, because the drive is accumulate more accumulation, more power. You have to inflict more damage. All right, thank you.
Thank you very much, Jonathan. We're going to open the floor up to questions. We have an audio recorder with us, and we'd ask that you hold it close to your mouth so that we can record your questions for posterity. I'm going to grab it right now.
Thank you. Find it quite amusing that you began by saying we must resist the gravitational pull of orthodox and heterodox economic theory, and then you spend an hour and a half talking about it, devoting only 1 minute to your own framework. I would have loved it if you spent an hour and a half on your own framework so that I could better understand what in the end just appears to me like some data that invites questions, but I don't know what you how you've given your answers to them. So in particular, I want to know what how your concept of crisis differs from that put forward by Marxist economists once you take the approach that you do. So are you saying that this is a terminal point that we've reached by virtue of the sheer expansion of ownership, the growth in dominant capital vis-a-vis the rest of capital, the expansion of capitalization into various different spheres? Is this a terminal process? If so, how do you judge that? How do we know that this is a terminal process? Because you've pointed already to previous dips. From what I can tell, the explanation you've given so far is that it's harder to increase from a higher starting point, but that's always been the case. So if this is a terminal moment, how do we know that? Once you take away the economic ways of answering these questions, what would a capital of power framework do in response to these questions? I'll just leave it there. I mean, I'm curious, mm-hmm. and bring in the concepts rather than hiding them. Thanks.
How do we know? We know in retrospect. I worked for a number of years in the financial sector trying to predict the future, but I don't believe that we are able to predict the future, and that I leave for the fortune tellers. I think the history is always humbling because it has all those sort of innovative aspects to it. So I don't think that we claim or that I can or that I want to predict the future. It's interesting to note, I just worked out these things in the last couple of days. This thing that you see here, this little change, last year when we worked out this paper, it wasn't there. So this is kind of a confirmation that this relationship remains stable. Of course, this doesn't answer your question. The question is, does this lead to a breakdown in capitalism? And I think that we don't know that for a number of reasons. The first reason is that this is just the United States. The United States is just 20% of capitalism maybe nowadays. And we have really no insight offered here at all to what happens elsewhere. So that's just a very partial picture. And maybe it's completely inverted in the rest of the world, and I wouldn't be able to tell you because we haven't investigated it. But even if this was the picture for the world as a whole, we don't know at what point the spring that sort of you press it eventually is going to explode in your face and strike you back, because that has to do with a certain autonomous moment that is created by pressing the spring, by inflicting sabotage. And the way that regimes change is always surprising to the ruling class, completely surprising to the ruling class. It is never able to actually predict those things. But it's never able to predict it because there is this autonomous moment that is generated by the very rule that represents the particular social order we live in. So the short answer to your question after this preamble is that we don't know. It's possible that this kind of capitalism can continue and inflict more and more damage. And instead of having, say, 16% of national domestic income going to capitalists, it's possible to have 20% or more. We can move to a slightly different form of capitalism that is much more oppressive than we have now, and nevertheless elicit no resistance and no significant transformative backlash. We don't know that. And I think it's good that we don't know that, because otherwise we would be automatons as well. So the answer to your question is that this framework is not meant at all to be a guide to the underlying population. It's an attempt to understand how capitalists might think about their own rule, because they view it really one-sidedly. From below, it looks completely differently, and this is not investigating it at all. I cannot use this to predict anything.
I accept that as a acknowledgement of how fickle and fluid social reality is, and social movements are, and responses to economic processes. That's fine. But by focusing for an hour and a half on two economic theories of crisis, you presented yours as an economic theory of crisis. And or as a political or power theory of crisis. And I'm not suggesting, oh, you can't do that, let's stick with the old ones. I'm very sympathetic. I just think that the future-oriented approach, mm-hmm. which you take, and which I think is a good direction to move in, requires maybe a move away from the concept of crisis. I don't think a future-oriented understanding of capitalism can have a theory of crisis that can compete with the two you've just lined it up against, because it operates completely differently. So you focus on capitalization, but there are many other ways in which capitalism is future-oriented. Capitalization is only one. And if we try to, I mean, obviously I haven't done this, but I'm just saying, if we try to think about the different ways in which capitalism, the future has begun to transform capitalism, then the ways in which the future acts upon the present and turns it in, and renders it a turning point within a social process, is no longer as straightforward as when you view it mechanically, either as, you know, an economic system based on utility or labor, right? So maybe there's a fundamental limit to how far the crisis idea can go once you see the future as productive of the present.
So you are suggesting that the term crisis needs to be seriously reconsidered, all right?
I don't think it can work as a concept.
But I don't know. I mean, there are a few people here in the audience that I know that work in the financial sphere, and they would be, I think, pretty comfortable with the idea of a capitalist crisis according to their own criteria. So I think that capitalists still think of a crisis. What we are trying to argue here is that crisis for capitalists is quite different and possibly diametrically opposed to the crisis for everybody else or for most people in society or for alternative groups in society. And therefore, we need a completely different conception of what the crisis is. But I'm not sure that I have a vocabulary or even a framework for understanding the capitalist process without the concept of crisis. Having said that, you know, if somebody is able to come with a system in which the word crisis is, you know, purged from, I'm fine with that if this is convincing. But I think that from my understanding of how the capitalist framework operates, the term crisis is pretty much ingrained in it. So I'm not sure how I can purge it altogether.
A simple question. Could you elaborate? There's one capitalist who is classically motivated, wants to maximize profit. A second capitalist is a capitalist power capitalist, wants to beat the average. How can you tell the difference? What is the operational difference? How would they behave differently?
Right. This is an analytical question because I don't think that the former capitalist exists anymore. So it's an analytical question. Now, what would be the different strategy of a capitalist that wants to beat the average and a capitalist that actually just wants to maximize profit? I think that as far as large firms are concerned, beating the average is something that involves a strategy compared to your competitors, direct competitors, immediate competitors, if you try to beat the average, say, in the oil business only. So that's a pretty limited way of trying to beat the average. Well, you're trying to undermine your competitors as well as increase your own earnings. And it's very, very important to pay attention to both because the interaction amongst large actors is a very complex thing. And game theory has made tremendous fortunes out of this idea of interaction. At the overall level, because increasingly capitalists are not trying to beat just the average in their own sector, they try to beat the national or the global average increasingly, that becomes even more complicated because you're operating in many, many different areas. For example, a capitalist might invest in particular production facilities, say, of energy, as well as financial activities, as well as service activities, as well as bonds, as well as commodities. And of course, the question then becomes a policy question. How can we influence policies of different countries? So at that level, I think the negative element is very significant. In 19th century capitalism, when firms are very small, I mean, we know in 1950, the size of the large firms was 900 times than the average. But in the 19th century, it was much smaller than that. The hope of undermining the average is quite limited. But when you're very large, that's a different story. It becomes entirely political. So that would be a short answer to the question, I think.
And the struggle between labor and capital, what you didn't kind of touch on at the end though was the kind of increase mechanization, particularly recently with robots really taking over the labor force, and we're even seeing it with say the kind of driverless car, which eventually will mean that say even simple things like truck drivers will kind of lose their jobs. So this kind of labor seems to have lost complete power.
I'm not sure I see that in that way. If you look at technical change, I think that the invention of the locomotive, for example, put all the donkey drivers and carriage drivers out of business. So if we think of mechanization as putting people out of work, everybody should be unemployed by now in a capitalist society. But I don't think that capitalism operates in that way. You develop new technologies that displace workers, but there are new technologies that actually employ workers. And I don't think that capitalists can conceive of controlling the world without putting people to work, because labor is a form of power. It's a major form of power over human beings. Nowadays, you control human beings in other ways as well. You control them through the leisure. In the past, you control them through religion. You still do. You control them through ideology. You control them in many, many different ways. But still, putting them to work is a very important way of controlling them. If you have a population that is entirely unemployed, that's certainly the end of capitalism as a system of power, but also the end of capitalism from a neoclassical or from a Marxist perspective. So there's always this transition from, you know, one form of technological development to another, and new forms of employment emerge. Without employment, I don't think that there can be capitalism. So in that sense, there's a complete overlap between our view and the Marxist, although for the Marxist, employment is a way of generating surplus value. For us, employment is a way of controlling human beings, a very effective way of controlling human beings, just as slavery was. I don't know if this answers your question.
Well, I think at the moment we're in this period of quite structural, I mean, I think you're right in terms of skilled peoples, but where there is a really massive problem is kind of lower skilled workers that aren't being retrained, aren't being, those new opportunities aren't actually there, because, you know, the job opportunities are in more of the higher skilled areas.
But in some way, this is a larger political question, because I don't see the technical problem of training people to do other things. It's just that capitalists are not necessarily interested in having them trained, because a certain measure of unemployment is necessary for power. It's a stick. I mean, you can train people. What's the big deal to train them to do other things? Just a set of priorities for society that capitalists perhaps are not particularly eager about. And there's nothing sort of mind-boggling in learning to operate mechanical equipment. Much of it can be done by five-year-old children, you know, playing with sticks and so on. And it's not more complicated now than it was in the past. If anything, I would say some of it is less complicated. So I think it's a political question, political not in the kind of a narrow sense. It's a political question for society to decide how to actually overcome the resistance of capitalists to good employment of people. This is part of the message I think we're driving at here. They don't want recovery. They don't want full recovery. There's, of course, a certain non-linearity. You know, full unemployment is impossible. No unemployment is very dangerous. But some unemployment is certainly necessary, as this chart suggests. You want to ask a question?
Thanks for your talk. I wonder if you could just comment about how your analysis might affect something which is quite prevalent in British politics, like on the left and political economy, about the 1970s. There's quite a lot of stuff written about what was going on there in terms of employment going up and inflation, and how Thatcherism, and you talked a bit about Friedman and that shift in ways of looking at things. But looking at your graphs, it didn't seem to me that there was that the big shift sort of showed up, that shift towards neoliberalism, like in your framework. So that's one question. What does your analysis tell us about what was going on in Britain in the 1970s in terms of the response to what was seen as a breakdown of Keynesianism and Thatcherism and all the rest of it?
Well, I mean, I don't have the data for the UK, but I think that the UK is actually quite similar the U.S. in this particular respect, from the data collected by Piketty and Saez, they show two patterns of redistribution, one that is V-shaped and the other is that is L-shaped. So inequality declining after the war, and in the V-shaped countries, which include the U.S. and Britain and maybe Canada, Australia, it's going this way. Whereas in other countries that are perhaps more progressive, it goes this way and there's some increase, but not much. So I think that the UK, if I remember correctly, again, I don't have the actual data here. In the UK, we still see, we also see since the 1980s, a resurgence of inequality. And I think that's sort of a backlash of capitalists against the threat to the capitalist nature of their society. So I think that the UK and the US are quite similar, and we had Ronald Reagan and Margaret Thatcher coming to quote-unquote power at the same time, but it's really re-empowering capitalists, and they represent a new direction, a backlash of dominant capital and capital in general against the threat to their dominance that Keynes facilitated. Of course, Keynes did not create it, but his theory facilitated because it enabled and justified and legitimized government intervention.
Yeah, so that would fit in with like existing radical analysis as of 1970s and Thatcherism and all the rest of it, doesn't it? That fits in with most sort of existing radical accounts of what was of Thatcherism and the crisis of the 1970s. You do see it as capital felt threatened and then retaliated and...
Yeah, I think that there are quite a number of overlaps between what we claim and what existing radical analysis suggests. I don't think that we are making a claim that the entire world should be seen with a mirror. You know, it's kind of the mirror image, not at all. What we are suggesting, though, is that the principle of analysis should be perhaps different, that we should emphasize a measurement of power as opposed to absolute measurement of capital. I mean, on the face of it, saying capital is power sounds nowadays almost trivial. What do you mean capital is power? Isn't it obvious? Well, it's obvious if you're not an economist. But if you are an economist, measuring capital is measuring machines or measuring time or measuring something real. So there is a serious dissonance, I think, between the idea that capital enables power and that capital is power. And if you think of capital as power, then the analysis leads you in different direction. But to say that there is no overlap between those arguments, it would be just false. There is quite a lot of overlap in terms of conclusions, but sometimes there is the complete opposite conclusions. So, for instance, we see stagflation not as a crisis for capitalism necessarily, and in, at least historically, it was a major boost when mergers and acquisitions were going into law. Well, whereas conventional analysis, both on the left and on the right, sees that as a straight crisis.
Yeah, I mean, that's kind of why I wanted to, sorry, I'll pass someone else off this. That's kind of why I wanted to ask you about the 1970s, because in conventional analysis, it was seen that stagnation was a social crisis that needed a response, right? But I was thinking, from what I understand of your analysis, it would seem that stagnation was a way that the capitalists were trying to reassert their power in a certain way. But it sounds like, in you know, the policy response to that seemed to be trying to do away with inflation and whatnot. So,
yeah, well, in our analysis, we wrote about it a while ago, and trying to contrast what we call regimes of differential accumulation. And we argued that there are two, that conventional analysis, again, both left and right, suggest that accumulation is about economic growth and price stability. And we sort of put the world on its head, and we said accumulation is about mergers and acquisitions, not economic growth. That's one driver of differential accumulation. And the other is not price stability, but inflation, and in fact, stagflation. But stagflation, we argued, is a very risky type of strategy that capitalists are dragged into or pushed themselves into only when their backs are against the wall. When merger activity dies down, they gravitate towards pushing prices up. And that can be achieved only by some measures, increasing measure of sabotage, then you have stagflation. If you look at this chart here, the period of stagflation, this always intervenes here, so I'll put the cursor on the side. And the period from 1970 to the mid-1980s, you see a major spike in national income. But if you were to look only on profitability, there was actually a lull and some decline in profit, and that was more than compensated by the share of interest in national income. So overall, the share of capital in national income during the 1970s and early 80s increased. In fact, in the early, late 1980s or middle of the 1980s, the share of capital in national income was the highest. That's the peak of the so-called stagflationary crisis. So in our earlier work, we did suggest that this stagflation was a means of accumulation. And in fact, the claim that somehow the 1980s was a major crisis in capitalism, we argue that that was objectively not the case, really.
I'm not quite sure whether you explained it already, but I don't really get why or how if dominant capital somehow benefits from crisis, and dominant capital is are big firms and very productive firms, how do they avoid a realization crisis then, if they? So how do if dominant capital benefits from crisis and unemployment to a certain degree, how do they avoid realization crisis? What is the theoretical explanation for that?
Well, realization crisis is about the overall volume of profit. It's about the overall level of growth. But we are not concerned here with growth or overall volume of profit. We are concerned with the distribution. So it's possible that overall growth is going to decelerate, maybe even go negative, but the share of dominant capital in particular and the share of capital in general might increase. So the period, say, of the 80s and 70s and 80s was a period of massive deceleration in GDP growth. It was considered a crisis for most people, but capital has increased its share of national income and managed to eventually increase its, you know, differential performance. But that's just distributional. So there's a fundamental difference between economic growth and distribution. And distribution can increase in favor of capitalists and dominant capital, sometimes in the midst of a crisis for everybody else, and sometimes because of that crisis. So that's why you need two different spectacles. The very contraction of GDP, or the deceleration of GDP, does not necessarily mean crisis for capital.
Anyone else? Don't be shy.
You mentioned that in some countries there is an L shape and in other countries there's a V shape. I wondered if I know you've acknowledged that you mainly use US data because that's the most readily available. Are there any studies that you've taken that you could kind of, I don't know, briefly delineate? I mean, I find it interesting if other countries have managed an L shape, which to me suggests a kind of focus on equality, whether it's intentional or not. But what would be why would some countries not try and benefit from that kind of capitalist power? And why would they maintain an L shape? What would be kind of what's the difference between countries that do that and the US and the UK, where inequality seems to be the driving force?
Yeah, that's why I'm delivering this lecture. I hope some of you are going to take it up and investigate it. It's one thing to actually plot those charts. It's a completely different thing to make sense of those charts. And it would be out of the top of my head to give you an answer, and it would be not really serious. I would have to look at what happens in Scandinavia, what happens in Holland, or what happens in France. And essentially, it's the balance of power, or the dynamics of power in those societies that dictate the distribution of income and the distribution of asset. And I think that perhaps the work of Piketty and others at least opened the door to some kind of analysis, because Piketty is just offering the data, but in fact, in terms of explanation, I don't think that he suggests or explains effectively why these processes have unfolded. What we are trying to do here is to offer some explanation of why these processes have unfolded in the United States. We found some stunning result. Whether these results actually hold in other countries, well, that remains to be seen. I don't want to imply that I actually know, because I don't.
Yeah, a couple of things. Have you heard it? You kind of just mentioned sort of Scandinavia, so I just wondered. I mean, Iceland's response to the crisis in 2008 was very different to most other countries. So I kind of wonder, you know, what the kind of the share has there been quite a different distribution of national income in Iceland as compared to other countries.
Iceland is a very, very tiny country in terms of the population, and I really don't know the facts about the distribution of income in Iceland. However, I think that Iceland is a good illustration of the global nature of capitalism. So in many respects, the accumulation, the differential accumulation that has gone on in Iceland, the massive redistribution, is part of a global process rather than part of what happens in Iceland. In that respect, even the United States is becoming increasingly problematic to investigate, because in the 1950s, about 10% of the profits of U.S.-based companies came from outside of the United States, and now it's about 50%. I think about half, if not more, of the companies listed in the United States are foreign-based. So the problem of limiting the analysis to a single country now have become so serious that they question the national boundaries that we impose on national accounts. And therefore, they put into question the very categories we use. And I think Marx's analysis of global capitalism was very prescient and very much ahead of its time in terms of the global drive of capitalism. And now we suffer the consequences of not preparing an alternative accounting system, because our accounting system is inherently based on national accounting, and we have no effective international accounting. We have some databases for companies. Those are not available for individuals to investigate. They're available only for institutions and so on. But we don't have anything more than that. So I think the dominant capitalists, the large firms, the large banks, have access to information that we mortals do not have. But even they are in the dark in terms of some of the global processes. And I think small countries such as Iceland, but nowadays even the largest ones, are starting to suffer from that. And we had a terrible time trying to sort out these data, and some errors that we encountered, that we made, forced us to kind of to redo things because of that cross-border transactions that now blur the national boundaries. In terms of ownership, this is really serious now. So that's what I can tell you about Iceland. It's a good snapshot of how the internationalization process is demolishing our analytical tools. Not just empirical, but analytical tools.
I want to ask you about the relationship between indebted governments, you mentioned the OECD countries, and the level of indebtedness they have, and how they may affect the role of, in general, governments as supporting property rights and the position of the capital, I don't know, elite or power power behind the capital class.
You have the expert right there. Wait. Well, for those of you who don't know, Sandy Hager just finished his PhD on the distribution of the ownership of the national debt in the United States. And what he showed in this dissertation was that, A, the personal ownership of the debt, as well as the corporate ownership of the debt, has followed this V shape that we see in the distribution of income more generally. So the debt has become, not only has the debt increased as a share of national income, but more and more of it is held by fewer and fewer hands. Now this is a very interesting, I think, finding. It's something that hasn't been done until now by anybody to map that redistribution process, and it's a very innovative and important, I think, discovery. And it's an interesting question to, I think, examine what kind of leverage capitalists have on governments. One possible leverage is the nature of government policy. It's not only just the size of government, but what governments want to do with their fiscal and monetary policy, especially fiscal policy. Who are they going to tax? What kind of projects are they going to be engaged in? You know, if you want to think of an alternative political economy which creates more jobs but doesn't change the climate, so you need a completely different ecological agenda Will capitalists allow it? Well, maybe in the 1980s they would have very little say about it because the nature of their concentration of power is much smaller. Nowadays they do have a say on it. So I think that that might have a very important effect on what can be done. You know, what kind of debt, for instance, can be eliminated. Some of the debt to large companies you can think conceivably could be eliminated. The governments can basically say, we're not going to pay it. Can they say it now? Well, possibly far less than they could maybe in the early 1980s. So that will have an impact not only on the ability of government to intervene, quote unquote, from, because intervention is a bad word, because it suggests that somehow you have an economy that is separate from government and the government comes in and intervenes. Well, I mean, there's no capitalism without government. That's kind of an impossibility, logical impossibility, and also historical impossibility. But government activity is not just about the size of government, but about what government does. There can be forms of generating employment that actually will reduce the size of capital and national income. Nowadays, I think capital is much better positioned to resist it than it was in the past. So I think that this is a worthwhile question to which I don't have an answer, but I can certainly appreciate the much stronger power that capitalists have over governments to prevent certain policies from happening. So you need a very, very powerful force from below to do it. And that certainly is possible. The question is, how do you organize it and how do you, you know, change the perception of what needs to be done?
I want to know about hype, because hype and fear are maybe related, maybe they're different versions of the same thing, different dispositions towards the future. So if the concept of, if the diagnosis of crisis here is that fear is systemic, for whatever number of reasons, we've reached, capitalization has proceeded so far, or whatever. So that if crisis is systemic, if we're in a crisis because fear is systemic, where do fears come from? And the other side to that is where you know, who generates hype? And is that not just as, if not more important in analyzing the transformation in actually existing capitalist economies, if capital is power, than kind of, you know, the more mechanical approaches, which we see coming through when we talk about leverage with the government on so and so. There's a fluid element in the theory, which is fear and hype.
Okay.
Yeah.
For those of you who do not know what hype is,
the idea of hype is that capitalists are forward-looking. They're trying to think of what kind of profit trajectory that will exist in the future and discount that profit trajectory into the present. That's not our invention. You read it in capitalist manuals about the stock market that were written already at the turn of the century with great elaboration of how you need to do it. So essentially, you have to project profit to infinity. I mean, they use this terminology. So the growth of profit all the way to infinity. It's ridiculous, but that's black on white. Into the present. Now, of course, this projection is meddled with the animal spirits, optimism, pessimism, but also is meddled with attempts of groups in society to create bursts of optimism and pessimism, because if you can fool everybody else to think that this is going to rise at 10% as opposed to 2%, then you can make a bundle and then you can actually fool them in the other direction and sell it short. So if you can manipulate investors to believe all sorts of silly things, then as a manipulator, you can redistribute income and assets quite effectively in huge quantities as opposed to relatively modest ways. However, I don't think that the fear here is associated with excessive pessimism. I think the fear here is anchored in the very fact that The share of capital in national income is at historical highs, and the share of dominant capital relative to the average is in historic highs. So this is, it seems to me, an objective condition rather than an historical condition as opposed to future condition, which presenting an increasingly more difficult future to harness the population, to sustain the population without major turmoil. And I think that the reverberations are seen around the world as a consequence of these levels, but they are seen around the world in a way that are not well informed, because most people do not see it from a power perspective. So I don't think that this is some form of excessive pessimism. I think that this is an objectively grounded fear that has to do with the fact that power now has been increased with a lot of sabotage quite effectively, and the way to increase it further will require much more of it, and it's more difficult. So,
just like the discovery of a new territory might have created more optimistic attitudes towards the future in terms of profitability or in terms of potential for differential accumulation, could not a new vista of the imagination, a new imagined future, change the objective conditions? I don't like the word, but in this case, change the landscape within which differential accumulation is pursued. I don't see how it could be objective.
I understand your question, but I think it's framing it quite differently for my answer. My answer is quite independent of the manner in which differential accumulation takes place, because it measures the consequence rather than the means by which it is achieved. So quite regardless of you using cold fusion for locomotion, or using combustion engine, still the distribution of income is more unequal now than it was over the past century, and possibly more unequal than it ever was in the United States. So it's quite independent of the means by which capitalism has actually achieved that redistribution. At the same time, this picture, as I said, is very limited. It's just for the United States. Maybe I'm missing your question, but I'm looking here at the consequences rather than at the cause.
I don't mean technology, like which is the way in which a business can make more money than its competitor. I mean a new story about what opportunity there might be making it be able to accumulate more vis-a-vis.
I mean, if you were to tell me that greater distribution of income is associated with inflicting less damage on society and can document it, then your question will be valid. It's possible, it's conceivable that you can actually dominate the population more. In other words, raise the share of capital from 16 to 20 or 25%, but reduce the direct sabotage inflicted on society. It's possible. But so far from what we see in the chart, we're not there yet. What we see in the chart here is that for the past 70 years, it has been associated with unemployment. And whether we can see a complete breakdown of that relationship, I agree that it's possible. But I cannot imagine it at this point. And if that will happen, that will be a different form of capitalism. And capitalism certainly mutated perhaps several times. So I'm the last one who is going to reject that possibility. It's entirely possible. Cannot just imagine it right now. And again, you are a younger researcher, so you know your project is lying ahead.
I hear a lot of clothing rustling and papers rustling, so I sense that the audience is getting ready to go. Do we have any other questions or comments before we wrap up? In that case, I just want to thank Jonathan for his presentation. Thank you all for attending today.